Hello and welcome to StudyIQ. In this lecture, we will continue our discussion on the Economic Survey, Chapter 4, Volume 1. The chapter is about reconciling fiscal federalism and accountability and checks whether there is a low equilibrium trap. So, till the last lecture, we have covered half of the chapter and today we will be continuing with the rest of the chapter. So, let us start with local self-governments. Let us briefly see what is local self-governments. The 73rd and the 74th Amendment Acts recognized panchayats and municipalities as local self-governments in India. Now let us see the 73rd Amendment Act. The 73rd Amendment Act recognized panchayats as institutions of local self-government. Secondly, this act has mandated that rural local governments or panchayats should have 3 tiers if the population of the state is above 20 lakh. So, this is mandatory if the population is more than 20 lakh. Also, under the act, the states were mandated to devolve functions and authorities to rural local governments in order to make them function as institutions of self-government. So, states were responsible for assigning them duties, functions and authorities in order to make them institutions of self-governance. Also, the constitution has listed 29 matters which could be the focus of their governance. So, exclusively they were given 29 matters by the constitution, and examples are agriculture, land reforms, minor irrigation, small scale industries, rural communication, drinking water, poverty alleviation programs, etc. Another important feature is that the state finance commissions were constituted. We have a finance commission at the union level. Also, there should be state finance commissions in order to devolve the resources between the states and the local governments. The state finance commission is responsible for determining the share of financial resources going to the local tiers. And we said there is a union finance commission, and the state finance commissions are analogous to the Union Finance Commission. Coming to the next feature, the rural local governments and the urban local governments were mandated to prepare and implement plans. So, what is the necessity of preparing plans by themselves? When they make their own plans, they will empower economically and also socially. They become more independent. They only know what are their requirements. They know it better than the state governments. So, they will become more empowered in terms of economic development and also social justice. Next, they were given authority or power to deal in grassroots development issues. So, developmental issues at the grassroots levels were dealt by the local governments. The same is with the case of urban local governments as well. So, they were recognized as institutions of self-government by the 74th Amendment Act. And two more schedules were added to the constitution, the 11th schedule and the 12th schedule. So, this is with regard to rural local governments, panchayats, and this is with regard to urban local governments or municipalities. Also, both the 73rd and the 74th Amendment Act, they gain significance from the Constitution according to Article 40, which is under the Directive Principles of State Policy. Now, coming to the expenditure patterns of different tiers of government, let us compare the expenditure patterns with that of rural local governments. When we compare the expenditure of central and the state governments with that of rural local governments, they spend, central government and the state government, they spend around 15 to 20 times that of the spending of the rural local governments. So, the spending of rural local governments into 15 or 20 times is the spending of the central or the state government. And when we compare it with urban local governments, urban local governments spend 3 times than the rural local governments. So, what can be the conclusion? The rural local governments spend very less. Their spending is very less. And one interesting thing we must note here is that the present data on spending on the rural local government, that is from 2010-11 onwards. Before this period, they used to spend 4 times lesser than what they are spending now. So, that was very less. And now, at least from 2010-11, they are spending 4 times than they had spent earlier. So, even then, the central government or the state governments are spending 15 or 20 times more than the rural local governments. And even the urban local governments are spending 3 times more than the rural local governments. So, rural local governments are the least spending and next is the urban local governments. So let us analyze what are the reasons for this pattern of spending. First and the most important thing, the overwhelming reliance on devolved funds. The local governments, especially the rural local governments, they are over dependent on the devolved funds. Now let us analyze the revenue generation pattern of the rural local government and also urban local government. Coming to urban local government, they are different from rural local governments. Why? Because they generate about 44% of their total revenue from own sources. Out of their total expenditure, they spend 44% by their own means or from their own resources. But when it comes to rural local governments, they are highly dependent on devolution. Around 95% of their resources are devolved or they are dependent on the state government for their resources. They spend only 3% of their own funds. And coming to per capita own revenue collected, the urban local governments per capita own revenue collected is 3%. And when it comes to rural local governments or RLGs, it is 0.1% per capita own revenue collected. Second important fact is that there is variation across different states, which means that different states have different extent of their own revenue generation. So with regard to states, it's not like the states are performing in a uniform manner. And also second thing is that within each state itself, different local bodies or rural local governments, they perform differently. An example is Tamil Nadu. In Tamil Nadu, within the state itself, different rural local governments perform differently. And we said that states are also performing differently. So better performing states are Kerala, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, etc. And some of the states who are poorly performing, it is Uttar Pradesh. Another thing to be noted here is that the Gram Panchayats, they spend this devolved funds on earmarked areas like roads, basic services, sanitation, community assets, etc. But they do not spend properly on purely local public goods like irrigation. So this is also to be noted. Another point is that institutional accountability is not properly measured. Or how accountable are they? How properly are they utilizing the devolved resources or their own resources? It is not properly measured. So if there is stronger accountability, this will definitely improve the performance of the local governments. Another issue is that in many states, the rural local governments and urban local governments have not devolved enough taxation powers. So the state has to give them the taxation powers. In many states, we will see that the taxation powers are not given properly. Examples of states who have given taxation powers or enough taxation powers to rural local governments and urban local governments are Kerala, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Gujarat, West Bengal, etc. So they are well performing comparatively in this area. So this is the fifth issue. Coming to the next issue, we have seen that states have constituted state finance commissions. But the reality is that a few states have accepted the recommendations in full or even to a significant extent. So even though there are state finance commissions, the states do not really accept the recommendations of the state finance commissions to a larger extent. So this is also one cause of concern. An example or exceptional example is the case of Kerala. In Kerala, the state finance commission's recommendations are fully accepted. If we look at some other states like 11% acceptance in Karnataka, 50% in West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, Rajasthan, etc. But when it comes to Kerala, it is 100%. Another issue is with regard to comprehensive survey. So there has not been any comprehensive survey in order to measure how rural local governments have fulfilled their mandates. So with all these findings, we can come to a conclusion. The rural local governments collect less than 10% of their total resources from their own revenues and urban local governments around 45%. So urban local governments are better performing. They collect around 45% and rural local governments, they perform very poorly, less than 10%. States have not devolved enough taxation power to the panchayats. So this is the reason panchayats or rural local governments are underperforming. So they collect only less than 10% of their total resources from their own revenues. And the reason is states have not given them enough powers. For example, if we take the case of taxes for the panchayats, this include property taxes, entertainment taxes, etc. But not land taxes or tolls. So tolls on roads, etc. They are not given authority, or panchayats are not given authority to collect them. So this is the reason why they are underperforming. And we said that property taxes, entertainment taxes, etc. are the main sources of revenue for the panchayats. But what is the problem here also? Property taxes are principal sources of direct tax revenue for the third tier of government. But the problem is that these taxes are stacked at a very low level. What is the reason? Because of the archaic base values. The base values are very less. The base values of such property taxes are very much less than the market values. So, because of this base value, they collect only very less revenue from this taxes. And also in some states like Odisha and Rajasthan, they are not given enough powers to the local bodies also with regard to property taxes. So, base value of property taxes are very less, and this is one reason the revenue collection is very less. And if we take the example of Kerala, what happens is that in Kerala, the land value or market values of land is very high, but the underlying notional values are very less. The base value is very less. So this is an example. The market value is high and base value is very low. So what will happen is that the property taxes collected will be very less. The revenue generated from property taxes will be very less. Some states who are better performing in this regard is West Bengal and Gujarat. Next point is that the population census of 2011, this gives an inventory of houses in the rural areas, but there is no such data available for commercial properties. So when it comes to commercial properties, no such data is available. This is also a major drawback. Now coming to the case of union territories, the actual collection in this union territories is on an average 30%. This is an average. For example, Chandigarh, they have no land tax realization. So on an average, it is 30% in union territories. So we can conclude that this under collection of direct taxes not only affects the center but also other two tiers. The center, states and the local governments are affected by this under collection of taxes. Now coming to the conclusion, the 73rd and the 74th Amendment Acts were watershed developments in India's federal structure. But what is lacking is realistically evaluate their performance. So what is lacking? Evaluation of their performance. It has been more than 20 years, but there is no proper evaluation done with regard to 73rd and 74th Amendment Acts or the performance of local governments. Second conclusion we can make is that our local governments or local governments in India do not conform to the cross-country trends. We have seen the examples of Brazil and Germany, and how do the third tier of government or the second tier of government perform in those countries. So in our country, they do not conform to cross-country trends or they are underperforming. Thirdly, the third tier of government in our country rely much more on devolved resources and much less on their own tax resources. So they are highly dependent on devolution of funds and they are not highly dependent on their own resources. Fourth conclusion is that they collect less direct taxes. As we have seen in the beginning, more the percentage of direct taxes, more will be development. And our local governments seem to collect less direct taxes. Fifth conclusion is that they are not fully utilizing the taxation powers they already possess. So some taxation powers they already have, that also they are not properly utilizing. And sixth point is that there is serious undercollection of taxes or resources. Seventhly, we can say that there is weak accountability mechanisms and weak on resource generation capacity. So accountability means they are not highly accountable, or in order to check the accountability, there are no proper mechanisms, and also there are weak on revenue or resource generation capacity for this local governments. A very important point here is the middle class exit to more privately provided services. So this is the ninth point and this is very important. So we have seen that the income taxes has evolved as social insurance. So what is meant by social insurance? We have already seen what is a social insurance. Social insurance means people give taxes to the state and the state in return provides social services to the citizens. So When there is a middle class access to privately provided services, means they are availing services from the private sector, like in the form of education, healthcare, safety mechanisms, etc. So what happens? They are less dependent on government services. And when people become less dependent on government services, what happens is that they are not ready to pay the premium. They are not getting services, or they are not interested to avail services from the government. They are dependent on the private sector. So what is there a need to provide a premium to the government? That is the question. So the middle class exit to privately provided services is one major cause of concern. And again, now coming to the cycle, there is an inadequate delivery. And this delivery inadequacy leads to low direct taxes. So when the delivery from the part of the government is less, what happens? People will depend on the private sector. So when people are highly dependent on private sector, they will provide less taxes. So the share of taxes provided will come down, and this will lead to weak accountability. Accountability will come down, and again when the accountability comes down, again the delivery will be affected. There will be lesser delivery. This is a cycle, and this cycle is the cause of governance challenge in India. So it starts with poor delivery. Poor delivery will lead to lesser payment of taxes, and lesser payment of taxes will lead to lesser accountability, and lesser accountability means there will be again inadequate delivery. So this is the cycle. These points are very important. Please keep in mind the reasons for underperformance of the rural local governments and urban local governments, or the third tier of the government. The reasons are very important. You must keep this in mind. This will be helpful even in your objective type questions, and also when you write essays or descriptive type answers. You can find the PDF of this lecture on my Facebook page, and also the video will be uploaded on the Facebook page as well. And the YouTube video link will be uploaded on the Facebook page as well. Thank you.